evening and welcome to tonight's City Council meeting. Tonight we'll begin our City Council meeting with the prayer and pledge led by Councilman Michael Balls.
In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful, we turn to you today asking you to guide the City Council to do the right things for the city of Saginaw and to bless all the employees and all the city residents so that they be safe in our city. And all this we ask in your name, amen.
I pledge allegiance.
Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Milne. Councilmember Tibbs. Councilmember Bench. Mayor Pro Tem Clark. Councilmember Moore. Councilmember Bryant. Councilmember Balls. Councilmember Humphreys. Mayor Browning. We have 9 members present, 0 absent.
Before we begin, I'd like to remind the audience to remain quiet and refrain from speaking there. This also was a good time to check your cell phones to make sure that they are turned down and don't interfere with the actual proceedings. So we appreciate that and also fellow council members. Madam Clerk, do we have any announcements?
Yes, Mayor, thank you. I'd like everyone to know that the city manager has issued a revised agenda. And that revision is the removal of the introduction of an ordinance. Also, the 2017 yard waste service will begin the first week of April. Yard waste collection is the same day as your regular trash service day. Yard waste materials must be in paper yard waste bags or in a 35-gallon or smaller garbage cans, not weighing more than 50 pounds. And they must have a yard waste sticker affixed to the front of the can. Also, what I'd like you to know that the staff members for the Downtown Development Authority will conduct an informational meeting regarding a 2-mill levy proposal and the potential improvements for the DDA district. The meeting will be held Tuesday, March 14th at 4:00 p.m. right here in Council Chamber. And with that, Mayor, we are at personal appearances.
And for personal appearances, we begin tonight's business to welcome your thoughts and your input. If you come to the podium, please introduce yourself and state your home address. To be helpful, let us know if you are speaking solely or on behalf of a group. All speakers will have a 3-minute limit, which is timed by the clerk, so be sure to cover your main points. Hearing from the citizens we represent is very important to us. We ask that you speak slowly and clearly so that we don't miss what you have to say. Finally, since you are speaking as a representative of all our citizens, we ask that you be courteous and respectful to the members of the public present, to the citizens watching SGTV, and to this council so we can give serious consideration to your concerns. All follow-ups will be referred to city staff. With that, Madam Clerk, our first personal appearance.
Our first appearance tonight is Paulia Williams. Okay, let's go to Roy Manning.
Good evening. Mayor and to council, to others in attendance tonight. I'm a pastor, Roy Manning. Maybe I should take the pastor off. I'm Roy Manning, 2619 Martin Luther King Boulevard East in the city of Saginaw. For those who are not familiar, close to the old fairgrounds. I'm representing the Renview neighbors and neighborhood. I'm one of the representatives at least. And we have lived there 30 plus years. And we are here tonight with some concerns about the seemingly deplorable conditions in our neighborhood. and trash, graffiti, cans, anything else that folks want to throw out. That's what we are faced with. In particular, the fencing on Ray Street, the old fairgrounds, whomever, we don't know who owns it. Because every time we call here, we can't get, it's like passing a buck or whatever. But anyway, from Weber all the way around that area, and all the way down almost to Hess, to that housing area, it stays with trash. The fence is in dire need of repairs. There are holes in it, kids are walking in and out, and we never know what's happening out there. It's constant litter from one season to the other. The snow comes, papers hidden, bucket cans, whatever else, debris, it's closed down. Spring come. Last year we made complaint several times. Finally, tractor came out, cut up all the paper, all the cans, all the bottles, all the cardboard, everything out there, and looked a mess. It was a mess. Now we have invested in our homes out there, and we're better than that. I think the city of Saginaw is better than that. I'm asking that the council, those who is in charge, would at least those who are in charge of the property, own the property, would be working on ordinances now. Make sure the ordinance is taken care of. People need to clean up the property. We are human, we live. We enjoy the area that we're in. We want to make it something special. We want the city officials to enforce that. The owner should be made to clean it up, and the city streets division should, I think, pay better attention to it. When you see stuff on it, on the streets, I think you are, it's incumbent upon you to send a truck out and get it up. We have a mattress out there on Hess, been there over 2 weeks, a mattress. And somebody ought to be responsible for cleaning it up. And as I always say this, we don't find it on Washington, we don't find it on Michigan. When stuff go on the street like that, we find a way to get it. And the citizens are not doing that. And so we've been cleaning up the last 2 or 3 years. I have, with a can and baskets, I don't think it's fair. We appreciate whatever you can do to rectify that area. Thank you so much.
Our next speaker is Cleveland Ducree.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Manager, Council Members, everybody that's attending tonight. My name is Cleveland Ducree. And I live at 2405 Robeson Drive, the street that needs fixing. I moved my family after building my house at the site behind Saginaw High, which is on Robeson Drive. It's beginning to deteriorate. It has been for the last 12, 15 years. I've been there 17 years. It's been deteriorating since I've been there. It reminds me of, as the mayor might know, of the 60s, where streets holes were sometimes 2 foot deep on the northeast side of the city of Saginaw. The last meeting with the supervisor that run the guys out on the streets there at my house, when I pointed out to Mr. Martin that the streets are so bad we can't hardly get out of the driveway. So he examined both ends and he said that the city were going to fix it after the weather gotten better. So there's the end of that. I stopped and asked him when he was on Congress Street that same the same time he's supposed to be over there trying to get my street fixed over there. And I asked him, when is he still going to come and fix it? This was the springtime. And now this was after the street had, that winter, the street done come, the street snow pushers had done come through and tore my street up. And it left holes and they started moving down through there because we don't have a curb out there on that place. Mr. Mayor and the City Council, this time I went to the city street department. And the engineer, Mr. Martin, came out to my street and She called me and said that they were working on our project at this time. The streets are in shambles, and I need them fixed. I can't get out of my driveway without stepping in the mud. I would invite any one of you members, all of y'all, to come out there to my house and stand across the street and walk across the street on a sunny day. Not like today right now, but 3 or 4 days from now, I can't get out of my house right now for the mud and the stuff that's keeping me from moving my vehicles out of my driveway, trying to take care of the handicaps that I have in there. We are all old over there now. We're sick and we're retired. We want to get some decency out of what we have over there, and we have been building up, and we'll study building and cleaning. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is Mildred Dorsey Bell.
Good evening, Mayor and City Manager, and to all of you. I'm here to represent myself at 2501 Martin Luther King Boulevard East and my sister at 2502 Martin Luther King Boulevard East. And one of the things that we have noticed for the past, I've been there 19 years, in the past 10 years after this fairgrounds has moved away, that when you cut the grass over there, you don't remove the debris. As Pastor Manning has said, it's still there. Lately, this year, they have dropped off yard waste in two different places where people have brought their garbage cans and dropped off the yard waste. Also, in the back of my house on Roberson and Tubman, there's a big puddle of water that's continuously back there because there are holes in the street right in front of Mr. Ducree's place. So we have the water where the street needs to be repaired. Needs to be taken out, you know, like you did Genesee a few weeks or months ago in the summer, dug it out and replaced it. That's what we need to do on that back street because it's been a continuous water flood. And also when it snows, the city comes through on 2502 across the street from me and they plow the snow and they tear up my sister's yard and they never come back to replace it. They say they're gonna come back, but they haven't come back to replace it. So. One of the things we're looking for is to repair the street, the yard waste to be picked up, the bed mattress to be picked up, and when they cut the grass in the summer, that they will pick up the paper and not leave the front of Ray Street where all of the debris blows over into our yards.
Mayor, that takes us to the remarks of council.
Council members, reminder of a 5-minute time limit. Tonight we begin with Councilwoman Annie Bench.
Thank you. I don't have much tonight, but I do want to say good evening to everyone here and at home. And I do want to thank our public speakers for being here tonight and bringing their concerns to us. Our staff is here and they've heard the issues that you've brought forward and hopefully they can find some resolution to the problems that are going on and get the trash picked up and address them for you. So that's all I have.
Thank you, Mayor. I don't have much to say, but I would like to thank the speakers for appearing this evening. Pastor Manning, Mr. Ducey, excuse me, Ms. Dorsey Bell. Thank you for your long-term citizenship with the city. It's citizens like you that give us a stable base to build upon, and I think the staff has a a pretty good track record of listening to your concerns and following up with those concerns. And you also shared what has worked for you in the past, so that's also a positive. So I'm sure they heard what you said and they will get back to you and help you with your issues. And thank you again for your long-term citizenship with the city. And that's all I have, Mayor. I guess I would just take this time and ask for volunteers for the Reed Association of Saginaw County. I've been a volunteer for Reed of Saginaw for the last few years, as well as a board member, and we still need one or two volunteers for Arthur Eddy. We have a couple of students there who are looking for mentors and someone to read with them. So if you have, I believe, 45 minutes out of a month for Arthur Eddy, and I think that's something you should look into. And that's all I have, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to reiterate what Clerk Santos said about the yard waste pickup. It doesn't start till April 1st. I realize the warm weather has got everybody jumping the gun a little bit, but we do have three more weeks to go on that. Compliments to the city staff in the income tax department. I filed mine 10 days ago, and I've already received my refund. So I suggest any citizen that is expecting a refund, you will get very efficient service there. The convenience station that the city maintains second Saturday of every month is also a good way to make sure you don't get a ticket for disposing of your trash improperly. And they take just about anything up to and including tires. The question about the trash against the fence along Ray Street on the former fairgrounds property, I cannot address a specific complaint, but I can tell you who owns that property. It is the Saginaw Housing Commission. And I can also say, from having previously worked in government, some of the hardest times to coordinate with people is other government entities. They have no tenant of the property. They do not have their own staff on the site. So day-to-day maintenance is probably quite a problem for them. It doesn't excuse them, but just so you know, it is not city property. It is the Housing Commission's property that we attempt to work with them to maintain the outside the fence portion of it. And that pretty much concludes my remarks.
I have no remarks tonight, sir.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, citizens. I'd like to thank everybody for coming to the City Council meeting this evening, and especially to the people that stay in the Saginaw High neighborhood that invested a lot of money in that neighborhood over there. I have been on that road, on Robeson Street, and it kind of looks like something out of the third world over there. I mean, because it's got a bunch of potholes in it, and it looked more like a dirt road more than it looked like a cement or asphalt. So I'm sure by you guys coming here this evening that the city is going to definitely get, that you guys know when they're going to come out there and fix it. It don't look good. And about the fairgrounds, I personally asked Wanagas Credit Union to invest some money in a drawing. We had a drawing. Michigan State University came out and did a drawing of the whole area. And Mr. Baldwin and some other people are working on seeing if we can get that property and turn it into a beautiful park area. I don't know if you guys knew about it, but we had a meeting at Roy's Church, and it was really a beautiful park with ponds and walking trails and bike trails and everything of that nature. So hopefully it'll come to pass eventually, I hope. It'll be a beautiful park for y'all neighborhood. I'm sure it'll make your house's value go up instead of going down the way things are going over there. So hopefully we'll get somebody out there to take a look at that. I don't think they want you to keep coming here to the city council meeting complaining about that. So eventually we'll get out and fix it. Mr. Tibbs was talking about mentors. Soft spot in my heart for people, for mentors. I've been in the Big Brothers and Sisters program for 30 years, on the board of directors for the last 5 or 6 years, and we need some mentors. There's a lot of kids here in the city of Saginaw who don't have anybody to teach them how to be good citizens, as you would say. A lot of kids are growing up with only one parent at home, and it doesn't take a lot of time. Sometimes just kids spending some time with you when you're cutting your grass or cooking food or just the normal things about life, because things are not that normal for kids who don't have parents at home, two parents at home, that is, because their mother may be at home, the kids may be by themselves, and they're raising themselves, and that's not a good recipe for a good adulthood. So hopefully we can get some more mentors, Mr. Tibbs, for the Big Brothers program and for the reading program. Other than that, I don't have anything else to say this evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's good to be here. I'd like to thank everybody for joining us here tonight, and thank you to our public speakers, Reverend Manning, Mr. Ducree, and Ms. Dorsey Bell. I can assure you that, as the Councilman Tibbs said, that the staff has a good record of getting back, so I'm sure they'll get back with you. I'm going to go down to that street as well and check it out. And it feels good. I got to say thank you to Councilwoman Moore. She was helping me. I rolled my ankle last week, and thanks everybody for their thoughts and concerns, and I'm doing better and glad to be seen. So that's all.
First, I'd like to thank everybody for coming out. My public speakers, I'm so delighted that you came. I'm so delighted because we don't know if you don't tell us. Now, I have brought up the Martin Luther King area several times. And so now, I think that we might really get something done over in that area. And it does look bad. And the road is horrible. It is a horrible road. We talk about dirt roads, that's worse than a dirt road with them big potholes. So I'm hoping, and I'm not hoping, I know that the city is going to do something, because we'd hate to lose anybody because of conditions. I know my uncle sitting back there, he on pins and needles waiting on me to say that. So we don't want to lose anybody. So we are going to start looking, I'm sure, at doing something to help. I'd like to thank the city of Saginaw for supporting First World Community Center on the Taste of Soul. As always, you showed up and you showed out. Once again, anybody who contributed or came and walked for Walk for Warmth for CAC, we had a ball. The attendance was high. I think it was probably the biggest attendance. Next year is our 10 years. And so if you thought this year was good, next year is going to be even better. So I hope that everybody comes out. On March the 22nd, 21st to 22nd, I'll be at a meeting in Lansing for MML. I'll also be doing workshops. I sit on the executive board for Michigan Municipal League. I represent the city of Saginaw. And so I do plan to do the city of Saginaw proud at this workshop. We too have our computers and our stuff that goes off too, so please forgive us. And with that, Mayor, I'd like to wish our mayor, who is going down, who's having surgery tomorrow, I want to wish him all the success in it so that he comes back to us really, really soon. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Reverend Manning, Mr. Ducree, Ms. Dorsey Bell, thank you for your comments. And I want to sort of echo what other council persons have said about, we know that the city will do what they can, but there is an elephant in the room that no one has addressed, so I'll address it. That elephant is a lack of funds and lack of staff. We don't even own some of the lands you're talking about, so to a certain extent, we can't even do anything on them. But to another extent, even enforcement is restricted for lack of funds and lack of staff. And those of you who know the city know that back by 1978, we had almost 1,000 employees available to enforce the ordinances of the city against these kinds of violations. And we used to have a budget that wasn't being reduced every single year by a tax cap. That tax cap every single year reduces our general fund budget to do anything like maintain roads and streets. We do get some money, $2 or $3 million per year from the federal and state governments for roads. But those are highly restricted in where we can use them. We can only use them on state and federal highways. Can't use them on regular city streets, neighborhoods. We have a little over $1 million, I think the figure is, per year from city funds set aside for fixing roads and streets, but we have 365 miles approximately of streets in the city. And it takes about $1 million per street to redo a road, per mile to do a road. So if we only get $1 or $2 million that's available for neighborhoods, you can see that's 1 or 2 miles out of 365 that we can fix up per year. It's terrible. We want these roads fixed up as badly as you do. We know they need it as badly as you do. But it's a money and staff issue. The tax cap, removing the tax cap would be nice. It won't solve the problem quickly, but it would help. Over time, we would have some more money coming in. The other issue is reductions of several million dollars over the last few years of state revenue sharing with our city. We've lost several million dollars in the last 3 or 4 years. That's a lot of money that could go towards some of these things. By writing your state representatives, you may be able to help us with that. Tell them we need these funds and explain why. Show them what you're telling us, that these roads are in terrible condition. So that's the elephant. Until we deal with that elephant, there won't be funds to do what everyone wants. So road repairs, road maintenance is done, and unfortunately, on a response, you know, people come and complain, so we try and do what we can, but we just can't deal with all of them. There's just not enough money. Mr. Manning, Mr. Ducree, Ms. Bell, Dorsey Bell, your issues are legitimate. And I wish that I had the answers. I know the city manager and his staff will try and respond the best they can and do what they can, but please understand there are limitations. That's the best I can tell you. With that, I think, Mr. Mayor, I mean, I'm the bearer of bad news, but someone's got to hear it, and someone's got to say it, and I'll do it. So please, do what you can. You're the citizens of the city. You have expectations. We have them, too. Help us with those expectations where we can get some relief through the state and maybe through eliminating the tax cap. Help us. Thank you. That's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Well, a couple things. Again, I'm certainly concerned about the old fairgrounds, and whether it's Ray Street or Weber Street or East Genesee or Hess. I mean, it's been abandoned. It's been let go for all these years. It's overgrown, and it's just terrible. I would like to see the city do what we can to help clean that up over there. I would encourage our group tonight to attend the next meeting of the fairgrounds. I mean, their meetings, please. It's not the neighborhood. It's the Housing Commission. Please go to the Housing Commission. Please, there's times where you can appear before the Housing Commission. Talk to those commissioners and tell them what's happening, because if we don't say anything to them, they're not going to do anything. It's unfortunate. I guess their funds are as short as anybody else's, but there's no excuse for it. There's still no excuse. It's got to be cleaned up, and it needs to be kept clean. So please follow through with the Housing Commission. I think that would be very well. We'll get a report back from our manager and street crews on what's happening in there, especially with the water issue. I know the potholes are terrible. The list is so long. The list in the city of Saginaw is just so long. 300 miles of city streets, and the biggest majority of them are in very bad condition. So hopefully we can get to that as soon as we can. Council members, I cannot encourage you enough. The MML conference is coming up. I know that's already at the end of this month. If you have not attended, please attend the MML conferences, especially the trainings for newly elected and some of the other ones. If you haven't already, please do. That's very important. I remember a couple of years ago, I was with Councilwoman Moore. We were at a conference, and with the Flint, members of the Flint City Council were there frantically getting their classes in, because they had changed their ordinance to make it mandatory, the primary training to be on city council. They made it mandatory, and so they were able to accomplish that. But I just hope we don't have to do that. We need to attend those classes. Those are excellent classes, and please, we have limited funds that we'll be able to do that. I know we did not go up to Mackinac Island because as $1,000 a day, that's not a viable conference compared to just a couple hundred. We'd appreciate that. Also, I'd like to just put a recognition out to Detective Sergeant Oscar Lopez, who was the March Officer of the Month, for his fine service to our community and outstanding leadership. Also, you've probably seen the email or the press release from Sergeant Reggie Williams on the multicultural training that occurred in February 21st and 22nd. And Sergeant Williams states, and I quote, "This was definitely the most engaging diversity training I've ever been to. The instructor's delivery was out of the box and connective. I'm glad I had the opportunity to participate." And I give kudos out to also to our department and getting all the training that we can to help serve our community so much better. So with that, we're done with council remarks.
Our next order of business is the reports from the manager.
Thank you. So to show how efficient our public services department is, you already have responses in your email box for the appearances this evening regarding the streets issues. Mr. Carwatt's department, I believe, talked to the individuals already and has put together memos in response regarding those streets. So they'll both have some repairs done, but I think they'll probably, at least some of them, be in line. I know Phil has mentioned to council before, but just to reiterate, there's about $330 million of streets work that needs to be done in the city, and we get about $5.4 million a year to do that work. Maybe some of the newer council members haven't seen it, but I know Phil's city engineer, Beth London, will be giving a report to council soon, but PASER is a rating system that we rate the streets by. Majority of the streets in the city are at a 4 or below, which is a reconstruct. So it's not uncommon, and I think the streets have lasted quite a long time for the way they were constructed, but it is time to do a lot of work. But it's a national issue, and I think you'll be seeing a lot more for streets, bridges, roads, and infrastructure coming up. And I know several council members mentioned the fairgrounds and talking to the Housing Commission. I would echo that as well. If there are specific issues with it that you want to contact our scenic about, we'll gladly pass that along to the Housing Commission as well, because we do work with them on demolitions of dangerous buildings, and also we've done worked pretty well with them and spent some of our demolition dollars on their property. So I think we do have a good working relationship. As far as I know, we don't cut any of that property for grass cutting, so it must be someone that they're hiring. So they may not even be aware that they're just cutting up all of the debris. So we can work on getting that communicated to the Housing Commission as well. And I wanted to make an announcement regarding our 2017 budget that Ms. Jones is working on the 2018 budget now, but she was notified last week that, again, the city's been awarded the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award for fiscal year 2017, and that's the 10th consecutive year from 2008 to 2017 that award's been given to the city. So I congratulate Ms. Jones and her staff at Office of Management and Budget. There was talk at the strategic planning session about transparency, and I think that's a good point, because part of putting together a good budget is making sure people can read it and you're communicating your points to the citizens. The Government Finance Officers Association is the organization that awards the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award, and to do that you have to be proficient in four areas: a policy document, a financial plan, an operations guide, and a communications device. So the communications device, I think, goes directly to transparency. So I'd congratulate Yolanda for working on that. It's a lot more work than just putting together the standard budget, so they do a great job with it. As the clerk mentioned, there would be a public meeting regarding the DDA 2 mil statutory levy. The DDA voted to pass that along to council, so that will be part of the budget process. If you recall, that's one of the things that was discussed during the strategic planning session as well. Those dollars, there is a plan for it. Mr. Miller and staff at Saginaw Future, who are the staff for the DDA now, they put together a pretty good plan and went around and talked to business owners in the district who would be paying the tax. So I think they've done a good job at putting together some projects that could be funded with those dollars. So if you're interested in that, I would welcome you to attend that meeting that the clerk mentioned in a few weeks. And the final thing I wanted to mention, we added it to our website, but there's a brand new event that's going to be on the river. It's called Row, Ride, and Run. It's a unique triathlon with a 5K kayak or canoe, 20K urban biking, and 5K urban scenic historic run. You can sign up as an individual or as team members. It is on Saturday, June 3rd, and it's got a lot of good sponsors and organizers. It's presented by Dow, and it's been organized by the Great Lakes Bay Regional Trail Group, as well as the Saginaw County Parks is working on that. So we've put that link on our city website and also on the Riverfront Saginaw website, so you can go there and see the flyer and hopefully share that with anybody you talk to about a new unique event in the riverfront. So we do have one presentation this evening that was requested at our last council meeting. Saginaw Future has been working with the city for, I know Joanne will be able to tell you because I believe that she was one of the first employees with Saginaw Future. I think it's been since the 80s, but the city was a co-founder of the group along with the county and the chamber, so we'll let Joanne get started.
Manager, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Mr. Manager, and city staff, it's a pleasure to be here tonight to talk about the partnership that we have with the city of Saginaw. Saginaw Future was actually formed in 1992 through an agreement by the city, the county, and the Saginaw Chamber of Commerce back at a time when there were three organizations and no one worked together and there were a lot of turf issues and everybody was trying to preserve their own job instead of having a single vision for economic development where we all work together. And it's been 25 years since we have formed the organization, so that's pretty cool. So tonight we're here to talk about 2016. You have a report in front of you tonight, but along with me we have two of our team members, Delana Spates Allen, who also started at Saginaw Future when I did, back when it was formed in 92, and Tom Miller Jr., who's been with us for about 12 or 13 years. And you see Tom every council meeting he's here. We consider him as our city staff, even though the rest of us also work on city projects. So this is a list of our board of directors, and we have 27 board members, including the mayor, the city manager, and a member of our audience here, Angie Miller from the Saginaw Labor Council. 27 members and more than half represent organizations that are located in the city of Saginaw. Our mission at Saginaw Future is to increase economic opportunity in Saginaw County by facilitating and supporting business retention, expansion, attraction, and new business development. And we strive to be seen as the premier organization providing proactive and focused economic development assistance, striving for diversification. So when the city, county, and chamber formed us, they had a couple goals. One is to have a single vision for economic development, and the second is to diversify our economy so that we don't rely on one single industry. So one of the most important things that we do at Saginaw Future is try to retain the existing businesses that are here and help them expand. We do that through a program we call the Corporate Watch Program. So last year we met with 130 C-level executives from the city of Saginaw, over 200 in the county together, but I met next year almost every week talking with them. That's our biggest manufacturer, our biggest employer. We need to keep them here because they're providing jobs not only in Buena Vista, but and not only in Saginaw County, but throughout the whole region. We meet with our not only our top employers like Covenant Healthcare, St. Mary's, Hemlock Semiconductor, but also companies that are smaller with 5 or 10 people. And I'm gonna have Tom and Delana talk about some of those examples in a few minutes. but we know that 80% of all the jobs created are from existing business and industry. So we talk with them about their plans for expansion, their barriers to growth, and ways that we can assist. It's our job to know all the tools that are available so that we can package those up and help support a company's expansion to help them be competitive so that they're able to expand here. So part of what we do is try to help them develop a competitive business case. We'll package incentives. You see us in front of you asking for the PA-198 abatements or the OPRAs or some of those incentives, as well as securing grants and funds from the state of Michigan, workforce and recruiter training, and also assist companies with government contracts. But we also help attract businesses to the area and help startup businesses as well. We have a website called the GreatLakesBaySites.com. It has the available industrial and commercial sites and buildings that are for sale on this website, and we keep that up to date constantly. When a company calls or the state calls, a site consultant calls and wants a site, or they have a request for proposal, we package those up, provide them with sites and buildings that meet their needs, and then if we're able to get them here for a tour, we'll pull together all the people that can help answer their questions: Consumers Energy, Michigan Works, Delta College, the municipality. So whatever they need to address their concerns or their questions, we have in one meeting with the company so that we can be as efficient as we can. We also provide information on demographics or research that a company needs to expand. So just a couple examples of companies that we've assisted this year. Through our Procurement Technical Assistance Center, we assist a lot of companies, but six of those companies actually secured over 105 contracts during 2016, resulting in $3.48 million in government contracts. So government contracts that's a good customer for our companies that provide stable employment. Mystiquay, Cygnus, Danaher, Meggitt, Merrill Technologies Group, SVRC, and Mobile Medical Response all received government contracts during 2016. We also assist them in getting state export promotion grants, and three companies, Banner Engineering, Maher Tool, and Duperin, were able to secure those grants. Those grants are used to help companies if they want to go to trade shows, get a booth available so that they can go to trade shows and help sell their products, or just to travel to a foreign country. It's matching funds so that they can try to get more exports is kind of the goal. And then the STTF is the Skilled Trades Training Fund that we work in partnership with Michigan Works. We help the companies write applications with Michigan Works so that they can train their employees on new technology typically. Mystiquay Group, U.S. Graphite, Mobile Medical Response, and International Materials all received STT grants last year. So this is a list of the companies that expanded in the city of Saginaw last year, and you have all that information in your report. But overall, there were 17 companies that created and retained 358 jobs and almost $18 million in new investment in the city of Saginaw, ranging from large to small. With that, I'll turn it over to Tom Miller Jr., who's going to give you some specific examples.
Thank you. Good evening, members of council. Let's see here if I can operate this correctly. First, I want to say that Saginaw Future, we work at the direction of the city manager. So Joanne and I meet monthly with Tim, and we get his advice and direction on each one of these projects. Secondly, we work on each one of these projects and initiatives with a number of partners, including city staff, the Saginaw County Chamber of Commerce, the Michigan Economic Development Corporation, and other state agencies, as well as other nonprofits and private businesses. But tonight I'll highlight the specific role that Saginaw Future played in each one of these projects. So a notable project, the first one is the Riverview Brownstone condominiums. Those are built by the Shaheen Development. It was interesting, we did a report to the governor's office and to the legislature. There was something like, we worked with John Stumpel, there was something like 10 building permits pulled in about a decade throughout the city, and that was about 10 years ago. So this was sort of a cornerstone project in the fact that this was the first market rate housing development in the city in a number of decades. The most important part of this project to move it forward was extending the Renaissance Zone benefit for the folks that live in the actual condominiums. We spearheaded an effort to educate our state elected leaders to help extend that Renaissance Zone, which was successful, and the project was completed. The next project is the Bancroft and Eddy. So we all know that was a big project, two of the main cornerstone corners of our downtown. A lot of work got done on this with a lot of by a lot of individuals. Saginaw Future assisted with a parking plan and OPRA and various other issues related to the development. Most significantly, though, we helped to secure a $1 million grant from the MEDC to complete the $7 million project. And that's obviously been a great success. This next one, the Menards project, this one is timely because we actually need your assistance on this project. Menards is completing an expansion of their facility. It's the only manufacturing operation in the entire state of Michigan, and they are investing $2.5 million and creating 40 jobs. We are working on a future expansion, which could generate an additional 60 jobs in the city of Saginaw. The project is contingent on a number of incentives and permits. The most notable and most important, first of all, is a wetland mitigation permit. We are working with the city engineering department, and we identified an area south of Wicks Park Drive, which has been vacant and unkept for many years. We have preliminarily proposed that Menards install a wetland park complete with walking path and viewing areas. This would do several different things, including will help us to pursue grants for the improvement of Wicks Park Drive and Wicks Park, which give preferences to the park systems which have natural habitats. It would also improve the overall aesthetics of the area. This is a tangible action that City Council can take to improve the Wicks Park area, to help move the project forward, to help improve quality of life for the residents, and thereby create some jobs in the city of Saginaw. The city of Saginaw would maintain ownership of the entire property, but Menards would hold a conservation easement over just the wetland portion of that property. And I know that the city manager will be working with you to try and bring this forward. Ultimately, Phil Carwatt and I and a number of staff in the engineering department have been working with the National Park Service to try and connect Wicks Park Drive to the Iron Bell Trail, which is a statewide trail which will connect Detroit all the way up to the Upper Peninsula. Just a couple of special initiatives real quick. We work on a number of projects that are not typically performed by economic development agencies. I will talk about specifically about Saginaw Future's role. On this first slide, I would just point out that we have worked with John Stemple and Phil Carwatt and the Land Bank on all of the NSP and HHF funds that have been made available to the city. In fact, we wrote the most recent grant, which secured an additional $2.2 million for blight elimination. Another special initiative is the SVRC Marketplace project. This again is going to be not only critical to the city of Saginaw, but I think to the region in general. If you've been to the one in Flint, which this one will somewhat be modeled after. How did Saginaw Future specifically play a role in this project? Well, we secured a $1 million DEQ grant to abate the asbestos in the building. There was significant amount of asbestos abatement needed before they could even begin to spend the additional $18 million on building out the market. We also helped to secure the $3.475 million Community Revitalization Program Fund grant from the state of Michigan. And just to give you a little window in sort of the operations and how these programs get rolled out, we actually meet every 2 weeks in the trailer, Beer Lines trailer on site with the DEQ, with AKT Peerless, with the contractors to go over very specific issues related to the development of this project's taking a lot of time, but it's going to be a very important project for the city of Saginaw. Delta College, along with the Chamber of Commerce, we organized and hosted familiarization tours with members of the Michigan House and Senate Appropriation Committees to showcase the merits of this project in downtown Saginaw. I don't think what has not been talked about, or what many folks don't see, is all college and universities propose capital projects to build new buildings, and they're very competitive around the state. So Delta College asked us and the city manager and the Chamber of Commerce to get together to put a good show on to our state legislators so that they would know the importance and prove that this project was a viable option. We helped evaluate sites for feasibility, and we will continue to work on the project until it is complete. Just two more special initiatives. The College of Medicine. Again, this is a cornerstone project for the region, not only the city of Saginaw. Joanne and I served on the CMU College of Medicine Site Selection Committee met often over the course of a year to help plan the project and select a site. We continued to work with the university on a variety of items related to community health and economic impact. And finally, as the manager alluded to, the DDA. So this staff member from the DDA took a new position in another community. We talked with the board and with the manager about the direction of the DDA, and it was asked of Saginaw Future to help take over the administration. What we quickly realized in meeting with the manager is that with all of these great projects happening in the riverfront, there was some need for additional revenue to support the development. We began a study to discuss and eventually developed a plan for a 2-mill levy. That's a statutory right under the DDA legislation. We have met with dozens of businesses and presented at every affected community group. And at last month's meeting, the DDA approved a resolution to recommend that council authorize the 2-mill levy. This will generate around $120,000 a year in revenue to help improve the district and create an environment to grow and attract businesses and new residents. We are holding an open meeting next week to take comments and suggestions about the plan, but preliminarily the plan, and you can see it there, it's kind of small, but it will fund a variety of activities included but not limited to improved lighting, beautification, trash collection, facade grants, wayfinding, grant writing, and security. Council will need to approve that 2-mill levy before we can move forward. So now I'll turn it over to Delana from our office to talk about procurement.
Good evening. I work in the Procurement Technical Assistance Center office. I have another staff member that also works with me named Sarah Strait. And as Joanne talked about diversifying and helping companies diversify and expand their businesses, that's what we do. We help companies obtain contracts from the state and federal government. And our office is really unique. We actually are funded by the Department of Defense, the Defense Logistics Agency, as well as the state of Michigan. And we also, in which Saginaw Future actually hosts our office. And Saginaw Future also puts in a little bit of the money for our funding as well. We serve 8 counties, whereas as Saginaw Future as a whole just serves Saginaw County. But we serve Saginaw County. We're considered part of Region 5 for the state of Michigan. And we serve Saginaw Bay, Midland, Clare, Gladwin, Aranac, Gratiot, and Isabella counties. So we go outside of the county of Saginaw. And as I stated, it is our job to work with businesses, and we work from small businesses, also work with large businesses, and helping them and educating them on how to do business with the state, federal, and the local government. So some of the assistance that we actually offer are one-on-one counseling. We help companies prepare their bid packets. Sometimes we have companies that actually have never done business with the state or the federal government, and they need to be educated on the process on how to sell their product or service to the federal government. So we'll hold their hand from the beginning stages of actually getting registered and what we call our federal system, which is System for Award Management, or with the state of Michigan, which is Buy for Michigan. And I know that the city of Saginaw also utilize the state of Michigan bidding process as well. And also, when you talk about local municipalities, we also work with Mitten. And so we educate them, and we actually help them get registered in the Mitten system. So they're able to do business outside of the city of Saginaw if they want to do business in other local municipalities. We also actually help them get certified. We have businesses come in. I have all types of businesses come in and work with them and getting certified as a woman-owned business or a minority-owned business. They want to do business with the Michigan Department of Transportation. We actually hold their hand and work with them and actually getting certified to be able to do business with. This month, I worked with Yancey Landscaping, which is a city business. I've worked with Leon Burns, who actually has the Right Spot, who also has a landscaping business also. I've worked with Taylor and Taylor Trucking, that's located right down on, it's a small business, it's a trucking business, and they were looking to how to market. So we work with any business that actually is interested in doing business with federal government or just needs some assistance in actually getting certified or possibly just getting being minority, if they want to get minority certified, or if they just need some marketing assistance, that's what we do. We also have seminars and trainings, and those are free of charge. And most of the time, they're located right there in our office. We have a conference room, and if a business needs to be trained on in a certain area, we'll provide that training for them. We provide market research. We'll go in and try to find out what is the government looking for. Have they actually purchased the product before? And if so, how much have they actually purchased? And also, which agency? And that actually would take a little bit of time off of the company so they don't have to do so much research and trying to find out which agency they should be selling to the government. Then other services, we also have a bid match service, and that utilizes the keywords. Say, for instance, landscaping. If the federal government is looking for a company to provide landscaping services, we'll put landscaping in, and every time landscaping comes up, it'll send them an email saying, hey, here's an opportunity for you to bid on the landscaping services if you're interested. And it's very unique because if we want to just restrict it to the state of Michigan, we'll restrict it to the state of Michigan. And if we can break it down just for the county of Saginaw, because we do have a VA medical center here, it'll actually let us know that the VA medical center here in Saginaw is looking for someone to provide landscaping services. And of course, we do the market research, which also allows us to be able to go in and find out how much the bid was the last time it went, the price history. And so that lets the company know, hey, I know that I need to be able to provide this amount so I can actually be in line with the pricing. So I will know that I'm not too high or I'm not too low according to the last time that the government purchased this product or service. We also provide military specification and standards, and that is really just the instructions on how to manufacture a product, which is something that we do a lot for Meggitt, Danaher Motion. They contact our office probably, I would say, once every 2 or 3 weeks asking us to provide them a copy of a military specification, mainly because they're getting audited. And once they get audited, they need to make sure that they have the document in place. And then we also have the Advanced Government Contracting Assistance, which is federal acquisition regulations. And of course, anything that you do with the federal government, they have to have regulations. And this is how the government actually goes about purchasing, what you should do and what you shouldn't do. And so we actually have to interpret that for our clients when they actually are looking to bid. And then unique presentation development, and that's just actually working with the companies and actually doing presentations. So as they go before buyers, they'll know what to say and what to do. So these are some of our successful clients that we actually have had. Danaher Motion, Merrill Technology, Cygnus, Mr. Quay, Mobile Medical Response, and SVRC. And as you can look at some of the numbers that we've actually had, this year alone, we have $59.86 million contracts awarded to businesses within the eight county regions, in which $3.48 million was for City of Saginaw businesses. We had 768 contracts, 105 came for City of Saginaw businesses. We had 10 first-time contracts, and out of that 10, three of them were City of Saginaw businesses. And then we had 67 new clients, which we signed 67 new clients, and several of them were from the City of Saginaw. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Delana. And the last program that I want to tell you about is Community Ventures. We're so very proud of this program, and it was designed back when Saginaw, Flint, Pontiac, and Detroit were identified as the four most violent communities of the top 10 in the nation. And the state came in and said that they wanted to address crime through not only public safety but economic development. And we've done just a phenomenal job in Saginaw County with all of our partners, each of us playing an important role with Community Ventures. Community Ventures, I think I passed that. I want to show you all the companies that are involved in this, including Morley Companies and Covenant and NextEar are probably the three biggest companies that are participating in the program. And if you look at in the whole state with Community Ventures, 5,554 jobs have been created, 1,371 have been created in the City of Saginaw, and that is significant because that's a lot of people that were chronically unemployed, they're former nonviolent offenders, or at-risk youth or veterans that were placed in meaningful employment, provided wraparound services, and helped funding in training and transportation and some unique partnerships with the companies like NextEar and Morley. Our role is to get businesses to sign up and be willing to hire people in those areas and give them provide training and the services that they need so that they can keep employment for the long term. And then other organizations like the Business Education Partnership provide the coaching that's needed. Delta College is involved with some of the training, and many of the churches are good feeder systems to identify the people that want the jobs that can get into this program. So we're really proud of the accomplishments. We're working right now with the state to try to expand that program and continue to keep it funded. For those of you who attended Saginaw Future's annual meeting, thank you very much. The manager asked us to take a clip of some of it and show it to you. So this will just be a couple minutes. But we're going to need some sound. We're not getting any sound. Yeah, we'll just, we can always send that to you and provide a link to the full video. But basically we had four of our community leaders, Dick Garber, Dr. Sam Shaheen, Jim Van Tiflin, and Herb Spence providing testimonials as past chairs of Saginaw Future about the program. And they have a passion for our organization, as does our staff, which you've heard. We're so proud of everybody because we hire people that care, that want to make a difference in other people's lives. So thank you so much for this opportunity. We're happy to answer any questions.
Amador Apartments, energy efficient windows, they are doing that right now. They have begun installation on that project.
Yep, Saginaw County was one of the first to establish the PACE district, and PACE stands for Property Assessed Clean Energy. What it does is allows a company like the new Amador Apartments to actually make $300,000 in improvements and put that on their taxes, so it's assessed through their property taxes and they can pay it over time. It's a lot cheaper. It allows them to have the funding today to make those improvements. So we're hoping that we get some attention and other companies will be interested. And I understand that you and we have a couple council members that are coming to our board orientation this week to learn a little bit more detail, meet all of our staff at Saginaw Future. So you're all welcome to attend as well. It's this Thursday at what time? 11 o'clock? We'll give you the time in a second.
The one that asked for a report from you guys, because we invest in you guys, and as city council members, I think we are ambassadors for the city of Saginaw to help bring business here and make this city look attractive. You know, so we want the whole city to look attractive. So that's why we're happy that you guys came, and maybe you guys can make a report maybe once or twice a year to the city council. Let us know what's happening, because we can't go out and tell people about what's happening in our city if we don't know what's happening in the city. Then we might read about it after the fact or something like that. But we want to be full-time ambassadors for the future of the city of Saginaw.
Thank you. We would be happy to do the report a couple times a year and provide copies to the manager so you can even put it on your website.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Are you guys planning on investing any money on the east side of Saginaw? I mean, there's a park project that we was talking about. Do you guys know anything about that for the Saginaw Fairgrounds?
Do you know about the park?
I mean, I do know about the fairgrounds project. I think, as the manager will back me up on this, we've met with the director of the housing commission. That property was purchased speculatively, and they have to sell the property. Right. So they're trying to get $400,000 or $500,000 out of that. So that's a hurdle that the housing commission needs to cross before they can do anything with the property. They need to either pay that back, as I understand it, or sell it to a developer for that, you know, for the amount that they purchased it with before any plans could move forward.
Well, hopefully maybe you guys can help us find a buyer or
I'm not sure if it's listed on our site or not.
Ago on that property, they did have an offer on it that their board considered at the last meeting, the last housing commission meeting. They did not vote on it yet because, and I mentioned in the up part of my update was because of the fairgrounds gate, that we have a historic group that would like to have that separated. So the housing commission board did not take action because they want to have a commitment to have that piece of property separated for preservation purposes before any deal is approved. Any deal that they have, even if it's an offer from a developer, that will then, I believe, go through their board and then go to HUD to be approved. And I don't know that I went to a meeting with the Housing Commission and regarding the Fairgrounds Park project, and the county treasurer did as well with HUD, and I'll tell you, and from our own experience too, HUD is very interested in getting their funds back, to say the least. So that'll be a key component is the offer of whatever funds that they're offering to purchase the property by. I think they will. We have worked on that Fairgrounds Gate project. Mr. Carwatt, through he talked Spicer into doing a free survey on the property to get a new description of the property so that it could be separated. So we forwarded that to the Housing Commission today, and city attorney has forwarded it to their attorney, so hopefully you'll see something on that property. I can't tell you what the developer or the investor will do with the property, but to have a private company purchase that, I think, will be a big benefit, and also to have that gate worked on, preserved, and made to site of interest for that neighborhood, I think will be a great benefit. So hopefully you'll see something on that pretty soon, I guess.
Development forward, we're happy to help, and we'll just look to the manager for direction.
Good. Thank you, I appreciate it.
You got.
Community ventures.
Yes.
I know it's an ongoing process. I guess my I have a question, and I guess I have a concern, because I know about it, but a lot of people don't know about it. Can we do some more advertising? Because there are actually, for example, there's a pastor in the room who is nodding his head at me. We need to know about this. And I know bits and pieces, so can I get some more information on it so that I can pass it on in some of these community meetings that we go to so that everybody knows? We know that everybody can't get a job, but we do know that if we can make a difference in one or two people's lives, it's going to make for a better community for us all.
That we can get to council members so you can hand out. And I'll just mention something about, I don't want to mean to interrupt Joanne, but there are a number of these projects. Joanne is one of the key people for that program in the county. So it's through Michigan Economic Development Corporation. Joanne works with all the companies. And if you're not real familiar with the program, right from the MEDC, it's for job seekers who are structurally unemployed, including the categories of lack of education, lack of functional literacy, long-term disconnection from unemployment at or below the poverty line, ex-offenders, at-risk youth, and disabled. So I think we get a lot of questions about employment opportunities for people in that group. So it is a great program, and Joanne has all the numbers. We can get you more. She probably knows some off the top of her head, but I think it takes a lot of work to get a company to buy into the program, and I think that's one of the jobs that Joanne does for us. And Next Tier, I believe, is one of the key employers in that.
Next Tier coming in and more with companies have hired hundreds of people, and they
look at it as a second chance, but they've all said that the retention rate of those employees are sometimes better than their regular staff.
That's
because
right.
They want to work and they need that second chance. So we feel pretty passionate about it. One of the problems we have is there's one staff member from the MEDC who's over not only Saginaw right now, but Flint. So I've just talked to her today. We're trying to get more of her time, and we're going to advocate to the state to expand this because we're successful here. So when you're successful, they should reward us and give us more funds so that we can help more people.
So did we find out the time for the meeting on
yes,
Saturday?
So we do a board orientation every year, and then we invite new city council members and new county board members, and it's this Thursday from 12 to 1. We'll even provide lunch, so you're welcome to attend. And we just talk, you meet all of our staff, we each talk about what we do and just try to make sure that you're acquainted with everyone so you feel comfortable in contacting them.
But we can get copies to council members.
Saginaw projects on the inside? Marvelous. I know 2015 project, Old Town Distillery. I don't think that are we doing anything with Oracle? What is the status of the brew pub and the distillery?
Yeah, I've been to both of those businesses because I live a block away from each one of them. I think it's a race to see who can them and Sandwich, as Yolanda will know. But each of those businesses have their equipment installed for the most part, their licensing okayed. I think they probably need a few final inspections from John's department. But I can tell you that all of them have significantly invested in equipment. So that's how you know they're getting ready to open when they've spent
no
the
grand
cash.
Openings announced yet?
No, I can't. I won't stretch that. But you would think they would want to be open by St. Patrick's Day, but I can't. I couldn't say.
Real quick, I'm assuming that the board orientation is at your offices on Washington?
Yes, third floor of 515 okay. North Washington.
Yeah, okay.
We can send out another invitation through the management.
That'd be great if you would.
Thank you for the presentation.
Did I hear there was a relationship or a connection to the land bank? You assist with their grant writing? Was that what their relationship was?
Yeah. So most of the grants flow through the city, HHF and NSP, but sometimes the land bank will do the administration. For this most recent round, we had Shalene from our office, who since now works at AKT Peerless, but we needed somebody to write the grant, so Shalene and I volunteered to put the grant together.
Thank you. And is that the extent of the relationship?
No. We do all of the sort of the number crunching, the maps, finding. NSP and HHF had some rules about you can't demolish structures in a historical neighborhood. You had to. We initially submitted the whole city in our application, and that was under the manager's direction. But then they came back and said you could only use certain census tracts. So we did the sort of the calculations and worked with Lori Brown's office to figure out what properties were in the worst shape and those kind of things, predict delinquency and default and all those kind of things.
Thank you.
Council members, any questions, comments? Well, thank you very much for your presentation.
So mentioned that that Saginaw Future works with the land bank at times when some of the companies in the city are requesting for homes to be demolished around their business site. Usually Tom works as a liaison between the land bank, trying to get them to do a little more work in those areas. So that's been a key for us as well. And from their presentation, you can see somewhat how their role has modified over the years. I believe they were initially started primarily for manufacturing and industrial attraction, but you heard Tom mention the Iron Bell Trail, which has nothing to do with manufacturing or industrial, but they've taken on a lot of different roles, especially in the city, not as much, I don't think, countywide, but especially Tom working with us in the city. He works on a lot of projects that maybe you wouldn't necessarily identify as economic development, but I think they go toward quality of life and improving the city. So I think that does involve economic development. Iron Bell Trail is one that I mentioned, and Tom also is on the Riverfront Development Commission, not as a Saginaw Future representative, but as I believe just a citizen and a business owner. But he's very involved in the city and works on a lot of projects that would be outside of the scope of what Saginaw Future does. They're also, we count on them to testify at the Michigan Senate and the House as well, because they do, they're known as the economic development experts in Saginaw, so they get called on quite a bit to testify. And I went with Tom for the OPRA legislation, which was also sponsored by our Senator Horn, but we testified at the State House Committee on that. So most of my information that I used came from Saginaw Future anyway, but they fill that role for us. And I think normally I don't think we presented on PTAC that Delana presented on, but that's a great program. And when she does her countywide presentation, as she mentions, all of Region 5, but when she talks about the Saginaw County's businesses and the amount of contracts that they've gotten through that program, it's pretty amazing. And we have to remember that not all of our residents work in the city, so they work at a lot of these companies that are in other communities in Saginaw County, too. So everyone is benefiting from these projects. I would just go back to one more that Tom mentioned, which is the Menards Project. And he talked a little bit about some wetlands mitigation. We've just done preliminary work to see if that's something that could be done, but I think it's a great opportunity. He mentioned it is at the south end of Wicks Park, which is near a county drain district anyway. If you know the district, the drain runs right through there. So I think Mr. Carwatt and I talked about it, and it's a great opportunity to help develop that area for recreation. We're thinking about trails and having that be kind of the nature trailhead point for Wicks Park Drive as a biking trail. Our long-term goal would also get involved with the Saginaw Land Basin Conservancy to help do work in there and raise funds for that. But I think utilizing this would allow us to start to develop that area as a more of a recreation area instead of just an empty, vacant area. Phil could tell you that a lot of people do hike back there anyway and walk their dogs. There's a small island with a bridge that the city repaired, that Mr. Stemple and Carwatt repaired earlier this year. And they ran into a lot of people that do use the area, so I think this could be some additional hiking and trail areas for that. The other good thing is it would help us bring more jobs to the city through Menards. If they don't do the wetlands mitigation, then they have to do that as part of this development due to the land that they're looking at. So what I wanted to do is I'm not asking council to approve the project. I think that would come later, but I want to make sure that that council is in agreement that we should move forward with that, so that that Saginaw Future isn't working on something and Menards working on something and city staff working on something that ultimately doesn't have a good chance to get approved. So I'm just looking for some comments about that as well.
Go ahead. Mayor Pro Tem, go ahead.
It certainly sounds like it's a win-win having a potential development of Wicks Park as well as potentially more jobs. So I would favor it. I think it's worth definitely exploring further.
I've seen the work that's already going on.
Continuing the expansion of that same site, to use the term, it seems like a no-brainer. They're making quite a mark over in that area, in what is a purely industrial area. It's not impacting residential or other commercial ventures. It's a very good use for it.
The council members, go ahead,
Linda. I'd like to get MML. Michigan Municipal League has been dying to get into this city since I got on that board. So I did give Mr. Miller the direct number to the vice president, who has been dying to get in here to help us do some things. So I'm hoping that we can partnership and get some extra money for the wetland so that we can get this on. Because it's jobs. It's a no-brainer. So I'm for it.
Any other council members? Concerns? Is there anyone opposing it, or has got concerns about it? Opposition or concerns? Okay. All right. I think the consensus then of this council is to move forward and bring some more formal details to us, and we look forward to any expansion we can do in the city with the parks and with business at the same time. I mean, it just, like you said, it just makes sense. So thank you.
Tom, we'll continue to work with them then on this, and it's a significant investment both in their manufacturing site and the wetland mitigation. And I know Phil and I have some ideas about that property and how it can be used for recreation. I think it will be much better than what it is now. And we'll probably try to get some of those old buildings demolished too. So it will be, I think, a lot more attractive than it is and useful for the residents. Okay. And with that concludes the management update.
Okay.
Mayor, we are now at the consent agenda.
And the agenda has been available at City Hall and on the city's website. Also, it's available on SGTV channel 191. I need a motion to approve the consent agenda, leaving room for exceptions. It's been moved and supported. Are there any exceptions? Being none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Next order of business is reports from boards, commissions, and committees.
Council members, is there any council members that would like to share any of their reports? Okay, go ahead, Councilman Humphrey.
Riverfront Commission. One of these sort of ad hoc subcommittees of that commission is the Art and About group. They did have their announcement at the Saginaw Art Museum a week or so ago about this year's summer projects, and they're bringing in an artist from Ann Arbor, a gentleman by the name of Mr. Zinn, who will be doing artwork in and around the riverfront through the course of the whole summer. More will be forthcoming, but it's really quite exciting. Last year we had the statues, which were pretty easy to see. You could even take a driving tour. This year the artwork is going to be pretty temporary, and it's going to be pretty small, and it's going to be located in a lot of different areas. It might even involve some searching. Mr. Zinn is going to be hosting classes or workshops for youth. These are little pastel chalk drawings that are fun, sometimes a little thought-provoking, and it really is pretty exciting. The other thing coming out of the Riverfront Commission is that a group is forming to start working on Ojibwe Island. Again, it's sort of an ad hoc type committee. I believe Mr. Bryant volunteered, Mr. Collison volunteered. I've tapped a gentleman by the name of Peter Brian Rose Berry, an SVSU philosophy professor, who's agreed to participate. The idea being getting a group of citizens together that are going to support the rehabilitation of Ojibwe Island. Had the opportunity to meet with Mr. Carwat a week or so ago and discuss the grant money that we are receiving, which is fantastic, but unfortunately it doesn't go as far as we would like it to address some of the other concerns and needs for rehab work on Ojibwe. So that committee will be meeting in the not too distant future, with the idea being trying to figure out how to generate some additional funds to do the work that needs to be done, and then to take it even to the next level. As the council recalls, and as the citizens should hear, Ojibwe Island figures into the vision for the city. And so if we can do whatever we can to turn it into a real jewel, we will do so. Cornelius Phelps from the New Ezekiel Project has also agreed to join the group. So it's some good people. Looking forward to it.
Any other boards or commissions? Being none, Madam Clerk.
We are now at motions and miscellaneous.
Is there any motions or miscellaneous business to come before the council? Councilman Tibbs.
I guess just a quick question. And consent agenda number 5, emergency repair, $212,000 for the 124 and 126 North Washington Avenue. I think when we discussed this at a prior meeting, there was a mention that there was a possible zoning ordinance which could be used as a possible tool for inspectors to get into these properties before getting into the shape that this property was in. And I didn't know if the city manager considered that a policy issue or a management issue. Is that something city council should ask for further guidance on?
To include in another ordinance. So basically, it's an idea that Mr. Stemple picked up from a conference that he attended, and I believe it's Detroit has an ordinance whereby part of your certificate of occupancy is an inspection. I don't know if it's annually or
every 5 years.
Every 5 years, that would be require an inspector to go through the building and make sure that it's maintained properly and isn't a danger. It would specifically, I think, address the dangerous portion of the building, because you see where you could have bricks or other items falling off. And if they deem that it would need repair, I think you could withhold the certificate of occupancy until such repairs are made. So that could be helpful in a lot of cases. This particular building wasn't occupied, so I don't know that he would have a certificate of occupancy for it, but definitely it is something, because a lot of the buildings that are occupied do need work, and we don't want to have, particularly if there are employees in there, people living in there, we don't want to have those dangerous situations. So you should see something coming hopefully in the next couple of meetings.
Physical concern is always an issue, but I believe the city residents have showed an interest in trying to preserve some of these, I guess, properties of some historical significance. And you know, if we can avoid, or at least be in a position to avoid a situation like this, it sounds like that could be helpful. But thank you, Mr. Morales.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. I'm with Mr. Prairie, with you here and the manager here both. I'm not sure this is within your wheelhouse, so to speak, but one of the things I think I would like to see for the city is, you're working on, this is Saginaw Future, you're working on business and economic development. Part of economic development, though, is to encourage the use of the available buildings within the city, but not just commercial, but residential. I don't know if that's something that could be in your area that you could look at. Or I'd hate to see another group have to start doing it, but some kind of a marketing program, some kind of a inventory, some way that we could make it known to communities outside of Saginaw the benefits of moving here. I think I mentioned a couple months ago about someone I met here who moved to Saginaw because of the quality of life. He moved from L.A. I mean, to him, this was a fabulous place to live. And the realtor that sold him that house had actually sold two other houses to other people from LA, saying, I want to move here. Well, there are people out there who, if they knew about Saginaw's quality of life, the advantages, the low cost of housing, all those issues, we would perhaps be able to obtain more residents within the city, which is an economic development issue. So is there something that we could ask Saginaw Future to look into or to address in that manner? Mr. Manager, I don't know if I want to throw it on your shoulders, but somehow we need to have some way to get the word out of who and what we really are and how attractive that we are as a city to people from beyond the Saginaw or the surrounding counties, from beyond Michigan even, to areas where, you know, the East and West Coast, where they have incentives to move out. And where should they go? We have a place for them. We have businesses that are highly, always looking for qualified tradesmen. We have great quality of life. We have great cultural attractions, all those kinds of things. But how do we get the word out? So is there some way that we could have of looking into that and coming up with an answer to those questions? I'd really like that explored.
Yeah, well, as part of the redevelopment ready communities that Ms. Jones is working on, part of that is having a marketing plan for your community. So that's probably going to be a part of it. I don't know how much Saginaw Future would be involved in that marketing portion of residential life, but they are involved in expansion of residential properties just by virtue of assisting people who are interested in investing. There's some potential investments downtown for at least two properties that would have additional residential housing, and they did a lot of work. Tom had on there the condos in Old Town, but goes all the way through creating a new law for those to occur that Saginaw Future worked on. So they work on quite a bit of that development. What we've seen from the new recent residential development They've been getting full, so there's some word getting out about living in Saginaw. The Bancroft and Eddy are the last two major rental developments, and those are both at capacity, and it looks to me like the condos are selling. At least there's a great incentive there, and I think that I think the Shaheens have committed to doing all three proposed phases of that. So I think there is a lot of movement, but we're definitely looking see what more we can do. Yolanda's nodding, so I know that's part of that redevelopment ready initiative.
Part of that process, and I think it'd be a, especially since they are promoting economic development from a business standpoint, you know, that's something, the quality of life and all those things are a huge part of it. So,
RRC with Yolanda, and I believe that Joanne is on the State Redevelopment Ready Commission board, right? Oh, Tom is. Sorry, Tom. But yeah, so they're both involved, and Tom's been working very closely with Yolanda on that, too.
Along the lines of Councilman's comment, some of this type of marketing is occurring through the Great Lakes Bay Regional Convention and Visitors Bureau. They have cooperative advertisements going into Midwest Living for this whole area, and that Midwest Living magazine aims all the way west to the Mississippi and as far south as the entire Ohio River Valley. So we're included in the lifestyle part of it. I would not say it specifically speaks to buy a house here, but it showcases the quality of life elements in the entire region very well. So we're getting some of it. As far as reaching the coasts, I can't say that that particular magazine does, but
I love you guys' comments, but the first thing we got to do is fix the roads for the people that live here so they would want to stay here. We got people that invested hundreds of thousands of dollars in their homes. Then we talking about bragging other people here. I mean, you got to watch what we're saying here. I mean, I don't want to get off on the wrong foot or anything, but I don't know if the city council should be telling people that we don't have money for roads. Let the city manager tell them we ain't got no money or see if we can find some money to fix it and then come back and say you want to invest. You can't have both. I mean, we want to have a good roads, we want to have housing, so we got to work those things too. So I would be careful with that.
We're going to have to step up out of our comfort zone, and we're going to have to start promoting the things that are happening. I know I talk about, wherever I go, I talk about this big old indoor-outdoor market. I got people wanting to come to Saginaw just to see our market. You know, I got them coming because I talk about the Bancroft Eddy building and the luxury rooms and stuff. So it's like we got to be our own walking billboard. I mean, that's part of our charge when we got sworn in. So I understand my Councilman Walker, I understand Councilman Clark. I still think it's going to come back to bite us. We're going to have to do it like you said in the judgment of claim. We've got to be more transparent, and we've got to step up our game and do what we need to do for the community.
Agree that we have to try and do what we can, fix the roads or anything else. But my hope is, by bringing people back into the city, we will start that economic development that will then bring in more jobs, more property tax, more income tax, the kinds of things that allow us to do that development, to improve the roads. I think they go hand in hand. Thank you.
Anything else from the council members? Motion to adjourn? Been moved and support. All in favor, signify by aye. Aye, those opposed.